Let's go down into a silent space. Seedlings waiting in the deep, rich ground, where the birthplace of new life is found. Holy silence, down here where everything is still. Shall we lie beneath the shadows of the great and mighty hills? Shall we hear the night bird calling? Calling our blind, distracted hearts. Shall we run from glaring sunlight? Give night a chance to play her part. Let's go down into a holy place. Let's go down into a silent space. Seedlings waiting in the deep, dark ground, where the birthplace of new life is found.
Welcome to Down Under, Part 2, Songs and Reflections about being at the end of the road, up against the wall, drowning. We use words like depression and despair, but there are so many feelings that have us at the end of a rope, at the end of a dead-end street, up against a wall, sat upon by a rock. Wearing brick shoes, I can't dance, I wear brick shoes. I'm drowning, I'm going under. And as I said, we've asked several friends to help us with the reflections and music about this. And we read over and over and over again about the increasing number of suicides and the increasing number of people who are going through depression. So it's a subject that really has meaning for our time. And so I'd like to sing a couple of songs first, and then we'll get down into some reflections. This is a song that I've sung fairly recently, but I think it really works in this time. This is called There's a Turning. Thank you. I remember that day you came over. Last person in the world I wanted to see was a minister, because I knew exactly what was going to happen. You were going to say, "Oh, well, we're missing you at church lately. Are you okay?" Then I'm going to have to come up with some kind of answer. And I haven't wanted to speak to anybody for days now. I get up late in the morning. I barely managed to get through a day. And here, you want to come at 10 o'clock in the morning and a little pastoral call. Gag. Give me a break. So there was the doorbell, and I stumbled to the front door and let you in. You looked at me, and you said good morning. And then you went right to the kitchen. I thought, what the heck is he doing now? I saw you had brought your little French press thing, your little fancy-dancy coffee maker thing with you. So you stood in my kitchen and you made 2 cups of French press coffee. And you came and you sat on the chair right across from my couch. And you just looked at me. Didn't say a word. Passed me a cup of coffee. I wasn't going to be the first one to speak. You looked at me with those eyes of caring and loving. And I knew you were just dying to talk, but I knew you knew better. So we sat and drank our coffee for about a half hour. You collected the cups. You washed the cups. And as you were leaving, you took your little French press thing. And as you were leaving, you said, "By the way, if you ever need me, I'm around." The clock
strikes 10. It's coffee time again, while the world is rushing to its judgment day, judgment day. We'll take some time and we'll try to find the rhyme. And if it gets too hard, we'll laugh the time away. Well, I know you say you're busy, but the pace can make you dizzy. Your heart attack is just around the bend, around the bend. Come and leave it all behind you, 'cause the craziness can blind you. And besides all that, I sure do need a friend. There'll be time enough to fight the windmills and all the battles that never seem. So from now till quarter after, it's a cup of love and laughter. So come on, old friend, it's coffee time again. There'll be time enough to fight those windmills and all those battles that never seem to end. So from now till quarter after, or from now till 20 after, or from now till 30 after, 40 after, 50 after, or from now till ever after, it's a cup of love and laughter. So come on, old friend, it's coffee time again.
So, my friends, before we start this next grouping of song and reflection, which sort of all goes together, a couple of announcements. One is, if you happen to be a church minister of music, and if you happen to have gone through one of our interlude retreats in the last 10 years, we've been trying to get a hold of you, and we may have not got your email correctly, but we are doing a virtual interlude reunion for all of our interlude graduates from the last 10 years. If you want to be involved in that, and if you're an interlude graduate, if you've been through our retreat, please email interluderetreats@gmail.com. Tell us who you are, and the retreat is next week, Tuesday and Wednesday. We'll send you all the information on it. The other announcement is twofold. One, next week, I'm taking a break because we're doing an interlude retreat next week. The week after, I want to do a thing that we're calling 6 Feet Apart. Now, that's a deceptive title. What I really want is, what are you learning? What are you struggling with? What are you dealing with in this time when we have to be locked down or 6 feet apart, or when there are so many people that we can't touch and make contact with? What are you striving with? What are you struggling with? I know Jane and I have some issues that we're really working on in this time, both among ourselves and also some public issues that we're really trying to read about and study about and learn about, which we'll talk some about during that time. But I really would love to have some stories from you about what you are going through and what's happening. Also, the other thing is, one of the things that I do in concert is that I do a improvisation where I take 3 notes and 3 words and compose a song based on those notes and words. Now, I'd like everyone who wants to submit 3 notes and 3 words. They don't have to be songish words. They can be words like, you know, flagellants, hyperbolic, strawberry. And they can be any notes, any old notes at all. That, you know, they usually come A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and they come in naturals and sharps and flats. So anything in that category will be just fine. The other thing is, if you'll download an album from our website, or if you want to make a donation to keep this work going, we'd love to get those donations. I'm going to ask Jane to come into camera, and I'm going to sing a verse of Healing of the Heart, then she's going to read. We have reflections from two friends, one of them on the West Coast, one of them on the East Coast, to read to you. These are people who've thought a lot and written about what depression looks like and feels like. And so we want to hear those reflections. But first, this verse. You ready, hon? Mm-hmm. Chosen, years go by, feelings get frozen, tear ducts run dry. It's time to move on, so they say. I'll try to forget all the ways that life bruised me and broke me, all the rage and regret. Where do we begin?
She says, depression is a path I did not choose. The unbridged chasm between what was and what is. Hijacked focus. It's being deaf to the words, just get over it. It's soul light unwittingly dimmed. Everything around me sounding like trivial, irritating noise. I can't tell you how sick I really feel because I'm afraid I'll be a burden. The bills need paying, the house needs cleaning, the groceries need purchasing, and the children need attention. And I'm paralyzed inside. My empty, illness-betraying smile is awkward at a family gathering. It destroys my dreams like a lovely drawing on a suddenly shaken etch-a-sketch. Anxiety's friend and abuse's foot soldier. It is the captor who mockingly demands I keep singing songs of Zion. I sense where the no-return edge is, and I fear it might win.
Been damaged in the house of my soul.
I try not to go there, where it's lonely and
the slows today. That's understatement. But everything takes more time to do. And I have no willpower, especially to get out of bed and not go back to sleep. Everything is gray and black. I'm swimming through molasses. Everything is foggy and I can't concentrate. Body aches. I feel like I'm recovering from the flu. So I take my temperature, and I'm disappointed that I don't have a fever so I could recover more quickly. I feel hopeless, helpless, hellish. I forget to eat. I'm too tired to tell the difference between hunger and fatigue. Or my brain tells me, endorphins, endorphins, endorphins. So I eat 4 or 5 bowls of ice cream, anything with chocolate and sugar. I'm not sad. I can't cry. Maybe I'd feel better if I could cry for days. I just don't have the energy to care or feel. I'm flat, stoic, empty. I'm standing in a river of sadness. Maybe everyone would be better off if I just go to sleep and never have to wake up. I'm so angry. I'm shaking with rage. Underneath is sadness and helplessness. I can't imagine anything I could do that would bring a smile to my face. My house is a wreck. I have passed through piles of paperwork and clutter that would be agony to sort. How could I possibly decide what to do with it when I'm too exhausted to even take a bath and change out of my pajamas? I'm useless, pathetic, stupid, a loser. I feel like a zombie. I have no substance. My life is over. It's all downhill from here. Hope is too painful to even imagine. And love is not strong enough to reach into the depths of my soul. My heart is dead. I feel dizzy and sick. I'm heart sick.
How did we get here? standing face to face. And this bridge, it could crumble beneath us. Such a dangerous place. We reach out our hands now, so fragile, so frail. Oh God, are you with us? And what if we fail?
So a song that comes out of my music therapy experience, and we've sung this before on concerts, but it probably has a good place here. You heard over and over and over again, I feel stoic, I can't cry, I can't feel. This song found its place among my clients in hospitals, and I'll sing it here. Behind your eye, I'll stay with you a little while, and it's all right to cry. You don't have to fake the smile now, you don't have to fight the fight. For this time we'll be together, and everything is gonna be all right. Are your feet sore and bleeding from trying to run away? Stay with you a little while, and we'll not run today. You don't have to play the game now. You don't have to hide the pain. And if it gets too hard to talk, we'll just listen to the rain. Let's go down invite Jane up on the camera one more time. And let me explain this next little section. And let me mention to you, by the way, if you want to help this work continue, we'd love to have your financial help. Your thoughts and prayers, of course, are terribly, terribly important, always. A reflection from another very dear friend, our West Coast friend. And this, really, there's some wonderful hope in this reflection. And after the reflection, I'm going to sing a piece called New Every Morning. This was originally written for choir. And it's a piece that quotes a wonderful passage from the Book of Lamentation. God's mercies are new every morning. God's love never ceases. God's mercies are new every morning. Therefore, I will trust in God. Now, what I do in this piece is that I do a section about happy mornings, about joyful mornings, when, you know, everything is fine. And then I do a section about those mornings when depression hits and when you can't stand to make it one more day. And then I always come back. And in this piece, I will have a little conversation with my own mind. So let's read first, and then we'll sing.
I grew up learning by observation, then practice, that a kind of common cold variety depression was a life skill. Especially at home, it was cultivated to mask grief, anger, or unpleasantness of any kind, to tamp down too much energy or wildness. Some days it was painful. On others, it was just a pall over any joy or delight that might possibly appear in my world. As I came into becoming myself, I became determined to find another way of living. As a young adult, I began a quest to know what shaped and triggered my depression and how I could live a freer, more authentic, and more delighted life. I began with learning about who I am with the help of so many wise people, ministers, mentors, therapists, spiritual directors, and authors. What I learned first was that my depression is not biologically based, but was imprinted on me at an early age by patterns of behavior in family and community. However, then I began to learn that if I could ride the wave of it, the great grayness, as I learned to call it, would come to an end. It was not who I am. It is a learned but deeply rooted fallback position. Over the years of my continuing, I learned to grow in spirit, to fall back into the loving arms of the Holy One, as I see it expressed in the Psalms. Even my darkness is not dark to you. Or in the book of Romans, nothing can separate me from the love of God in Christ. That learning calls me to take time, treat myself patiently, bathe myself in music, wait and hope. And most often, I emerge from my depression in a better place. I grieve with those whose depression demands medical attention and care, with those who are isolated or without resources, or those who are systematically left out of care systems and the administration of justice. My personal part on the living of these days is to pay attention to my own heart, even when it lapses into depression, to name my feelings, and to do those practices that anchor me while I'm waiting for the wave to land, and then offer who I am to walk and talk with others who also encounter the great grayness. For God's sake, for the healing of the world.
love of God never ceases. God's mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning, great is God's faithfulness to me. God is my portion, says my soul, therefore I will hope, therefore I will hope. Now and then, when I wake and all is well, so I linger long in bed and I listen and I watch as nature casts its spell. And the music on my lips joins the music of the birds, and my heart is like a river overflowing with the words of delicious adulation, of surprise and celebration. My heart is like a river overflowing with the words of love. Steadfast love of God never ceases. God's mercy never comes to an end. They are new every morning, great is God's faithfulness to me. God is my portion, says my soul, I will hope, therefore I will hope in God. I have known those days when morning means another day of weeping with no comfort and no answers, and no reason left for rising. I have awakened to those mornings when there is no reason left now, no emotion, in silent sorrow, and I want to run away, and I cannot face tomorrow, and I cannot face this day. I cannot say those words today. I will not say those words today. I cannot. I will.
Mercy never comes to an end.
Somebody say them for me. I will not speak those words nor sing that song.
They are new every morning.
No, 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 no. To me,
God is my portion, says my soul.
Grief is my portion, says my soul.
Therefore, I will hope.
I have given up hope.
Therefore, I will hope.
I have given up hope. In
think that I am hungry. And I think that I'll go walking in the sunshine and in the rain. And every sound is like a something that I've never heard before, like a fragrance, sweet perfume. And the magic of this moment is the wonder of a day. Beyond the grieving and the gloom, beyond the grieving and the gloom. The steadfast love of God never ceases. God's mercies never come to an end. Great is God's faithfulness to me. God is my portion, says my soul. Therefore I will hope. Therefore I will hope. My dear friend, the brilliant choral conductor and composer, Craig Hella Johnson, who is the conductor of a wonderful choral group called Conspirare. He's also the conductor of the Cincinnati Choral Ensemble and several other things, has written this gorgeous, gorgeous setting of Emily Dickinson's poem, Morning. And for those who are going through what our friends have gone through and what many who listen to this music are going through right now, this is an apt question, I think. See if you don't agree.
As day, could I see it from the mountains if I were as tall as they? Morning, morning, where does morning lie? Like a bird, is it from some famous country of which I have never heard? Morning, morning, where does morning lie? Kindly light amid the encircling gloom, lead thou me on. The night is dark and I am far from home, lead thou me on. Guide thou my feet, I do not ask to see the distant scene. One step enough for me.
from the sky. Please to tell a little pilgrim where the place called morning lies. One of my dear friends is a therapist and counselor and writer, has written many, many books, beautiful, beautiful poetry, and leads a number of seminars that we do with Interlude. She tells this story about the days right after a terrible, terrible automobile accident when she and her young child and husband, she was only in her 20s, they were driving from one state to another, and they were struck by a drunk driver going 100 miles an hour who had crossed into the wrong lane, and her husband and daughter were killed, and she survived. She did have the baby with whom she was pregnant, but in her days of great grief, living at her parents' house for the time being, she says, I could not even get out of bed. I could not even move. I couldn't understand anything. And there was a woman who lived next door that we had known as children. We called her Grandma, and I won't mention the last name. We called her Grandma. And my friend said, she was old by this time. But every morning, I could hear the sound of her little heels clicking in the hallway. And she would come in. We always left our doors open in that time, in that little town. She would come in the morning, and she would come into my room, and she would place a bowl of custard on the nightstand. And then she would just stand there for a minute and look at me. Not a word was said, and then she would leave. Some mornings she was just too old and too tired and too weary and too in bodily bad shape to make the custard. So she would bring to me a piece of Wonder white bread. That's what we ate back then, she says. Wonder bread with butter and sugar on it. One couldn't get much more unhealthy. But she would bring me a plate with a piece of Wonder bread with butter and sugar, and she would put that on the nightstand and just look at me with eyes so full of compassion, and then walk out. Didn't say a word. Didn't need to. And my friend said she was one of the primary forces in my recovery process. One of those people I will always remember for her silent loving. Teach me to stop and listen. Teach me to center down. Teach me the use of silence. Teach me where peace is found. Teach me to hear love calling. Sometimes without a word, teach me to hear in silence things I have never heard. Teach me to be collected, teach me to be in tune, teach me to be directed, silence will end so soon. Then when it's time for moving, granted that I may bring to every day and moment
silent spring. I want to be like you, Grandma, to know when to talk and when to shut up. I want to be just like you, Grandma, to know what to put in someone's cup. To know the peacefulness of silence, to know when to say a word, to know when to bring the bread and sugar, and just listen to the singing of the birds. I want to be like you, Grandma, with a peace that never ends. I want to be that listening presence for all my enemies and friends. And when it's time for moving, grant it that I may bring to every day and moment peace from a silent spring.
In just a minute, I'll ask Jane to come up again, because we'll end on a somewhat lighter note, another story. But first, I want to just mention a couple things. One, taking a break next week, we have an interlude retreat. There'll be over 30 previous interlude participants over the last 10 years. We've had about 300, but there'll be more than 30 at our virtual retreat. And by the way, if you're a music director and have been through interlude and we haven't contacted you, please email interluderetreats@gmail.com. Whoa. interluderetreats@gmail.com. We will get hold of you and register you for this virtual retreat. It's next week, Tuesday and Wednesday. We have two sessions, one on Tuesday night and one on Wednesday morning. And we'll have so much of the old gang and some new faces, and I think it'll be a wonderful time. So no concert next week, but the week after that, 6 feet apart. What are you learning? What are you discovering in this time of COVID, in this time of racial movement, can I say, in this time when a lot of questions are being asked? It could be a pivotal time. We can hope it'll be a pivotal time. We'll talk about some of the things that we're learning, and I'm eager to get stories from you. Plus, send me 3 notes and 3 words. We'll make a choice. We'll have a whole bunch of these, and we'll make a choice as to which one. We'll pick them out of a hat, so to speak, and I'll compose a song based on those notes and words. So, a little story about two moms and their sons who had gone through the doldrums after school ended. The moms were both teachers, and figuring out, what in the world are we going to do this summer for our boys?
My friend and I are both teachers and moms. For 10 weeks this spring, we pulled ourselves up with the bootstraps to create learning experiences for both our students and our own children. Some days were more successful than others, ha! We missed the physical friendships with our school communities and made do with car parades and a drive-through graduation. At last, we reached the finish line, the last day of school. After a long nap, the question became, now what? Every summer trip, adventure, and camp we had planned as mothers was canceled. After weeks in the doldrums, we made a plan. If we quarantined at home for 2 weeks, we would feel comfortable, we decided, meeting up at a cabin by the lake. We unearthed and fine-tuned Grandpa's old sailboat on the side yard, and we hitched it to the back of a borrowed truck. We also borrowed 2 paddle boards and rented 2 kayaks. We packed the cooler, drove some hours up the mountain, and I wept when I felt the warm hug of a lifelong friend. During school days, she and I had our boys read, write, run, paint, and subtract, etc. At the lake, these 13-year-old boys were able to provide something for each other that we could not provide them in no time. They were grunting, wrestling, sword fighting with branches, burping, and it was music to my ears. After exploring the woods and lake, they found an island. The next morning, with a dusted off spring in their steps and glint in their eyes, they packed their own lunches, without being asked, to share them on their island. They were like withered plants, receiving sunlight and water for the first time in 4 months.
Help me find my island. Help me give it a name. Help me find an adventure. Help me find a game. Even when we sit behind a screen, and I cannot be with you skin to skin. Help me find my island and invite me in. Help me find a new way. Challenge me a bit. Something that will use my body, my mind, and all my wits. We'll be distancing for a long, long time. That's just the nature of the game. Will you help me find my
So there's one last piece that we want to do today. We've sung this one too, but on these concerts, but I think it really works in this setting. Thank you, all of you, who contributed so beautifully to these two events. Thanks to all my reflectors. Thanks, Jane, for reading. Sonia, for wonderful videography. Beverly, for sound checking back at home. Robert, who is going to put this concert on YouTube for us, and jimmy up the sound so it's really classy. Thanks to all the people who have made this possible. Again, I tell you, if you'd like to donate, please feel free to do so. InterludeRetreats.org. We do lots of conferences and retreats. We're bringing musicians together, bringing songwriters together all over the place, and keeping these concerts going week after week. And I get lots of letters that say, we really need these concerts. So next week, no concert, but there's all the older Facebook concerts are there still. So grab one of the older ones. And upcoming events, we're going to be doing a very exciting event with my friend Nancy Sehested. Nancy has been a prison chaplain for years. And she's going to tell some of the stories from her new book, about her experience. She's going to tell some of those stories, and then I will sing songs based on the stories she tells. We'll be doing that sometime in the very near future, so look forward to that. Be sure you send me some stories about how you're doing in the COVID time. And let's have this last song. Thank you again so much for being a part of this.
me to thy bosom fly. While the nearer waters roll and the tempest still is high, hide me, oh my Savior, hide, till the storm of life is past. Safe into the haven guide, oh receive my soul at last. Plenteous grace with thee is found, grace to cover all my sin. Let the healing streams abound, make me, keep me pure. Rise to all eternity.
Good night, everyone. Have a great week. See you in 2 weeks.